Alessandro Ferreri. I was visiting research fellow in Holocaust studies at the Australian Centre for Jewish Civilizations at Monash University, an honorary research associate at the Australian Centre for Italian Studies. After his postdoctoral research fellowship with the University of Este, he completed his book, Leggera Musica e Resistenza, about music and resistance in the ghetto, Legge da Resistenza. His research focuses on persecution and exile of Italian Jewish musicians from conservatories and theaters during fascism. Laurie is an honorary research associate at the Australian Centre for Italian Studies and a lecturer of Italian at Australian Catholic University. Her research extends from gender and cultural studies to post-colonial and media studies. After her PhD at La Trobe University, she published her book, Incontro di Africa. Her current research project, The Ain't No Black in Tricolor, investigates the connection between post-colonial studies and the ongoing social changes in contemporary Italy.
Before beginning any discussion about exile, it is necessary to specify that the question of exile is virtually absent from the field of Italian studies, with the exception of analysis of the exiles of the Renaissance and the exile of anti-fascists to France, Switzerland, and England. However, in both cases, we are dealing with political exile rather than intellectual. What is missing within the field are studies comparable to Anglo-Saxon exile studies or the German Exilforschung. While the phenomenon of exile has affected all ancient and modern civilizations, the specific case of 20th century exile is unique and cannot be compared with any of the previous occurrences. The topic is complex and has always been the subject of interpretative controversies due to the variety of experiences that it tends to include: social exile, political exile, intellectual exile. Using Italy as the site of our research, today we will compare the exile of two groups in two different historical periods, highlighting some similarities and the most revealing differences within these experiences of exile. These groups are the Italian Jewish musicians and composers during the fascist period, and the Somali intellectuals during the Siad Barre regime that lasted from 1969 until 1991. We will touch upon the specific examples of the Italian Jewish musicians Renzo Masserani and Gualtiero Volterra, and the Somali intellectuals Mohamed Haider Sheikh and Nuruddin Farah. Jewish migration, catalyzed by fascist persecution, was a revealing event in the 20th century Italian history. It was followed, among other things, by a brain drain that had profoundly negative impact on both scientific advancement and the Italian culture as a whole. To understand fully the exile state of mind, I would like to quote a passage from a letter written by composer Renzo Masserani. Exile in Brazil on the 27th of September 1946, he wrote to his friend, the composer Alfredo Casella. Appena liberata Roma, uno dei primi nomi a cui ho pensato è stato il vostro. Di noi poco da raccontarvi. Abbiamo continuato anche durante la guerra una vita scialba, mediocre, da spostati pieni di rimpianti e saudades. Io ho superato poco a poco la mia malattia. Ho lavorato per mesi e mesi, 20 ore al giorno, dando lezioni di tutti i generi, scrivendo musica per compositori locali, facendo orchestrazioni variopinte. Mi sono malinconicamente guadagnato il pane, senza la minima soddisfazione. Adesso avremo un enorme desiderio di tornare un poco in Italia, sia pure soltanto per far visita ai parenti e agli amici. Ma la spesa è troppo grande per le nostre possibilità. E bisognerà aspettare ancora chissà per quanto. Masarani's description perfectly encapsulates the exile's emotional and psychological experience, the weight of alienation from one's motherland, and the nostalgia that this memory generates in the mind and the heart of the one who chose or was forced to choose to live in search of refuge for political or racial persecution, or some future employment or professional future. Contained in Masarani's words is one of the most significant elements of the experience of exile. In other words, tied to the notion of distance, which is simultaneously the torment and the privilege enjoyed by the exile. Renzo Masarani, born in Mantova in 1898, was considered the most promising Italian composer from the beginning of the 20th century. A volunteer in the First World War, upon his return, he became a committed supporter of fascism. Despite his initial commitment to the fascist cause, in 1938, he was affected by the Italian racial laws. In particular, his works were considered degenerate music. Masarani had not recognized the anti-Semitism inherent in fascism. And with profound disillusionment, at the beginning of 1939, he sold everything in his possession and left Italy for Brazil. Why Brazil? For two reasons. The first, because he first applied to migrate to the United States, but his application was rejected because while he spoke four languages, English was not one of them. The second is the fact that the Brazilian music critic, Mario da Silva, whose wife was a German Jew who had met Masarani in Germany, falsely claimed that there was a job for him in Rio de Janeiro. It was in this way that he was able to obtain permission to migrate to Brazil and save his family in May 1939. He settled in Rio de Janeiro, ceasing work on his own compositions, but continued to write music for others. He forbade the public performance of his work, which had been banned by the fascist regime, part of which remained unpublished, forbade their republication and wanted to destroy most of his music. Masarani had resentment towards Italy, fascism, and towards himself for having placed blind faith in a dictatorial and oppressive regime. To earn a living, he worked as a critic for various Brazilian newspapers, and he became a member of the Academia Brasileira de Musica, thanks to the Brazilian composer Villa-Lobos' intervention. He refused to return to Italy permanently. He died in Rio de Janeiro in 1975. The other musician I will discuss is the pianist Gualtiero Volterra, born in Florence in 1901 and deceased in Florence in 1967. Volterra came from a famous Florentine family of antiquarians. Due to the racial laws, Volterra left Italy for Australia with his non-Jewish wife towards the end of December 1939. Why Australia? For two main reasons. The first, because Volterra's wife was the Australian Patricia Kelly, daughter of a wealthy Sydney family. The second is the fact that a friend of his, the Polish Jewish pianist and composer, Ignaz Friedman, who had remained in Australia after a concert tour, had advised Volterra to leave Italy as soon as possible and to join him in Sydney. Volterra's two brothers, who after the promulgation of the racial laws remained in Italy, were eventually deported to the Mauthausen concentration camp, where they died. Volterra's story is inextricably intertwined with that of Ignaz Friedman, because Friedman also convinced Volterra to resume his work as a pianist. They had abandoned 13 years before. Due to the anti-Italian sentiments in Australia during this period, Friedman had to convince venue managers to allow Volterra to tour because he wanted him to perform before his return to Italy, planned for 1946. And here we have a series of articles about his various concerts. The phrase, the great pianist, but no mention the fact that it was due to his Jewish origins that he was forced to leave Italy. Masserani and Volterra's individual experiences of exile are very different. Both decide to leave Italy due to racial laws. However, for Masserani, it was a definitive departure, while for Volterra, it was only a temporary stay in the host country. Masserani had to endure all kinds of difficulties to integrate himself in the new country, from language to employment. For Volterra, the host country was his wife's country of origin, and because of this, he didn't face huge difficulties of integration. Despite these differences, the experience of exile had a profound effect on the lives of both musicians. Masserani never composed his own music again, while Volterra, after his return to Italy, never again performed on the piano.
Similar to Masserani's story of political betrayal is the story of Mohammed Adan Sheikh. The era is different. This time we are in 1980s, and Italy is the country where Aden, a Somali politician, intellectual and surgeon, spent his exile. So when talking about exile, it is important to highlight how the host country has been chosen. But in this case, it was almost a natural choice given the colonial relationship between Italy and Somalia. During his youth, Aden even spent two periods in Italy. The first time was in 1953 to study education, and the second time was for 7 years in 1957 to study medicine and surgery. In 1969, a coup d'etat put Siad Barre and the military junta into power. Aden was then asked to become a member of the Civilian Committee of Secretaries of State, and later as a member of the government in various capacity through the years. After 12 years dedicated to his country, he went on a collision course with Siad Barre. And in 1982, Aden was incarcerated in a supermax prison in solitary isolation for 6 years until a short trial in 1988 that freed him. So after that, however, Siad Barre sentenced him to house arrest for a few more months until the 21st October 1988, when, on the 9th anniversary of the coup d'etat, Aden was declared a free man, but forbidden to leave Somalia. So a few months later, he applied for a passport anyway and asked permission to go to Italy to visit his children and undergo some medical treatments to regain his health after the incarceration. So to his great surprise, both these requests were granted, And on 5th June 1989, he left Somalia to stay in Italy for a short period of time. But in fact, he ended up spending the last 20 years of his life in Italy. Because soon after he arrived, the civil war broke in Somalia. So while he was incarcerated, two of his three children left Somalia for Italy on study scholarships. One of them, Kaha Mohamed Aden, went to Pavia to study a bachelor's degree in economics and business and would later become a writer. So it is through her that I got to know his story. Recently, I started to study his books, in particular his autobiography, La Somalia non è un'isola dei Caraibi, Somalia is not a Caribbean island. And this is the first time that I have worked on a memoir. And the reason why I think Aden's story is so relevant when talking about exile, it's because of his involvement in Italian local politics once he moved to Turin. And we can touch on that during the Q&A if you're interested. Similarly to Renzo Masserani, Aden not only resides and works in Italy, he also felt the urge to contribute to his new country's well-being. And the reason may be that as a Somali, he always felt a special connection to Italy. And in his own words, i Somali sono cresciuti con l'illusione di poter considerare l'Italia, non dico come una seconda patria, ma certamente come un paese amico, sotto le cui bandiere hanno combattuto e sono morti tanti Dubat Somali e Askari Eritrei. So the translation of this passage is mine, unfortunately, because there is not an English version of his book or of his books yet. Kaha, his daughter, has just recently completed a crowdfunding to translate them, and I personally think it will be a great project which will increase the visibility of these texts and will make them available to students and scholars not only of literature and cultural studies but also history and politics. So, of course, when talking about Somali intellectuals in exile, one must talk about Nuruddin Farah, probably the most famous Somali writer in Western culture and especially in English-speaking countries. So it is not well known that he began his exile in Italy, in Trieste and in Rome in 1976. And I will quote for his book, Yesterday, Tomorrow, Voices from the Somali Diaspora, published in 2000, in which he collects and narrates the stories of Somali refugees and also describes his own exile. I arrived in Rome in July 1976 as a traveler. I had come from Paris, intending to continue my journey to Mogadishu, Italian spelling in the text. In Paris, I had said no to the possibility of a half-offered teaching job at a university in Canada because I was clear in my mind that I had unfinished business in Mogadishu and with writing, the métier of my commitment. I changed from being a homeward-bound traveler in transit to an exile and become the proverbial hunchback who must get used to his misfortunes. I tried to trace Mogadishu all the way back to Italy through my writing. I may have felt more at home if I had been I who had chosen Rome as the city of my exile, willingly exchanging the status of a journeyer from that of an emigre. End of quote. And to describe the relationship between Somalia and Italy, he quoted Mohamed Aden Sheikh. Perhaps it is not a surprise that Somalis are nearly invisible in Italy. The connections between Italians and Somalis are obscure on both sides, a curious legacy on their colonial encounter. Italian colonists in Mogadishu lived apart from their subjects in far more sumptuous circumstances. There were no channels of communication, no place or occasion for encounter. There were two societies in parallel existence, neither talking account of the other, as the political scientist Mohamed Aden Sheikh observed in Arrivederci Mogadishu. There is a certain amnesia about the whole affair. Sheikh was truly surprised to discover that present-day Somalis knew little about the era of Italian colonial rule. Italians, in turn, are convinced that their colonialism was less brutal. than the empires of Britain or France. End of quote. And when discussing his own situation, Nuruddin Farah clearly states that he never felt safe in Italy. So I said, suspecting that the authorities were keener on being on Siad's good book than in mine, I tried my damnest to remain legal, not when he came to employment, but with regard to my stay permit. So, end of quote. So therefore, he did not stay long, because even after sorting his visa problems, he still did not feel like he could live there. A friend lent me an apartment for several auspicious months after the concierge of the building in which my French partner and I shared a tiny apartment with a Maltese woman reported that a couple of suspicious-looking characters had paid me a visit, possibly from Siad Security Services. So what no one told them, because even the concierge had no idea, was that I had gone into hiding and did not emerge until after finishing sweet and sour milk. I never felt safe in Italy, and I left at the first opportunity, end of quote. So to conclude, given the universality of the exile experience in the last century, we can reason that the intellectual and artistic movement of the 20th century have all been influenced by some form of uprooting. So by its nature, it is evident that exile, whether cultural, artistic, literary, or political, it is a transcultural and a transnational experience that transcends borders. So after all, exile writers and intellectuals do not belong fully to either the country of origin or the host country. So the Italian-Somali author Cristina Ubah Ali Farah offers an effective description of the exile's alienation in her novel Madre Piccola, Little Mother. Sai di quegli anni, quello che non riesco a fare è descrivere i luoghi. Era tutto movimento interno, da una casa all'altra. Essere potevi essere ovunque. Per me, per tutti noi, era indifferente. Alienandoci, vivevamo. End of quote. So the author expresses the profound sense of estrangement within the exile. And this estrangement manifests in detachment from one's surroundings in the host country, a sense of home felt only within the domestic space of the dwelling. So the passage could apply to Volterra's exile in Sydney, and it seems to echo what Nuruddin Farah says about his exile in Italy. And I quote, "It occurred to me that I was not living in Italy as much as I was dwelling in the country of my imagination, an ideal land with no connection between it and the landmass known to me." End of quote. On the other hand, Masarani and Aden Sheikh seem to have found a place where they belong. So we can apply Aden's words to Masarani's experience, perhaps. Quando arrivai in Italia, non prevedevo né il mio destino di rifugiato né il fatto che alla mia incancellabile identità somala si sarebbe sovrapposta una seconda identità cittadinanza italiana. No, se anche un giorno riuscissi a tornare in Somalia, non vorrei e non potrei staccarmi dalla mia identità italiana. In either case, the original laceration is still present, and exile is an alienation from one's own self, regardless of the condition of the host country. So perhaps it is felt more acutely in those who are aware of leaving their homeland indefinitely, as in the memoir written by Mario Castelnuovo Tedesco, Italian Jewish composer who fled to the US from Trieste's port. So, quel che provai in quel momento non lo saprei ridire. A chi non conosce l'amarezza dell'espatrio, non lo può immaginare. Non si può parlare di dolore, di rimpianto, di sofferenza morale. Fu quasi uno strazio fisico, uno strappo, una mutilazione. Mi parve quasi la prova generale della morte. E da allora qualcosa è definitivamente morta in me, ma non la speranza, ma l'illusione. E se qualche cosa mi ha tenuto in vita, è stato l'amore per i miei cari e l'amore per la musica. Grazie.
Ernesto Livorni is professor of Italian language and literature, comparative literature, and religious study at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. His scholarly publications include Avaganda in Tradizioni, Ursa Pound and Giuseppe Ugaretti, and T.S. Eliot Montali Amoritas. His most recent collection of poems is Onore e Padre and la Madre, Poesie, 1977 to 2010.
It's always a pleasure to be in New York City, and it's certainly for me a pleasure and a suffering experience to speak about migration, exile, impossible returns, as I also was tempted to call this paper. However, the title of the paper is Motherland, Fatherland, Homeland, the Paradigmatic Trajectory of Crossing National Identities. And I understand that the three American words, motherland, fatherland, homeland, are basically translating one Italian word, which is a very problematic word nowadays, has been a very problematic word after fascism, and that is patria. And I'm interested in exploring what actually patria means, what actually patria hides underneath its semantic roots. And I think the English variations, motherland and fatherland, who have been that have been abandoned, and homeland, which is very current nowadays, may help us in exploring the the existential substratum that links migration, expatriation, exile, uprooting, and so forth. And that's what I try to do in this short paper. Short, that's good news already. Migrants leave their lands already with the awareness of the impossibility of homecoming. You know, just Mohammed Adin Sheikh, or Nureddin, I'm sorry, I forget which one, but the fact that he was saying that even going back to Somalia, he could not get rid of his Italian identity that he had acquired, you know, I thought, yes. I mean, it's sad on the one hand, but on the other hand, it's yes. So, migrants leave their lands already with the awareness of the impossibility of homecoming, and if they leave with the hope of that homecoming, they are called in due time to develop a consciousness of the relative permanence of their condition, which is at best the condition of those who live between two worlds. If the awareness of the impossibility of homecoming is not immediate, it affirms itself in a short time, which is also a useful process because it is important that the migrants come to terms with their condition of migrants, indeed, and also expatriates and exiles. That condition implies, first of all, a life away from their beloved native lands or familiar places because of an economic situation that evidently must be considered primary in the hierarchy of their needs. Migration is a phenomenon marked by economy and market on the one hand, and the opposite economic need of the migrants, which become the supply of labor meeting the demand of the welcoming capital ready to offer employment. In this economic relationship between supply and demand, the migrants find their new condition onto which they must embrace as a form of redemption. Redemption may affirm and express itself on several levels, economic and social certainly, but also existential. The migrants' awareness of their condition as outcasts and outsiders may also bring understanding of their condition as expatriates, hence of their condition of exile, especially when they have to acquire that awareness for their own health and salvation. Not all migrants are conscious of or able to elaborate the passage from the awareness of migration to that of precipitating to the condition of expatriation and therefore exile. Sometimes the lack of such awareness may very well be a good thing, bliss of ignorance, I guess. The resentment against the country of origin and provenance, guilty of not being capable of providing those means to make a living in vain, becomes an efficacious push for that form of redemption which allows the migrants, at least at the economic and social levels, to affirm themselves in the foreign land. To be sure, resentment is nevertheless a form of alienation, a form that is so much more dangerous and sad because it is double. On the one hand, the migrants have not assimilated themselves in the mechanisms of the land of arrival. On the other, the migrants are further severing, cutting off, burning the bridges with the motherland. The migrants then find themselves in a life between two worlds. The migrants find themselves and their identity as migrants in that oscillation between two worlds, which becomes the pendulum of their existence. You know, this morning I was listening to a paper talking about the new modalities of migration, or mobility being a very strong element in redefining migration in the era of globalization. And I understand that I'm relying more on the kind of migration that Italy witnessed until World War I, especially, and we can go all the way to World War II, although between the two worlds, as we know, migration was less intense than previously. However, my dream will be that of constructing a paradigm that works at the existential level for today as well. But and perhaps in the Q&A session we can go back and talk about this if you're interested. The condition of the migrants may overlap that of the exiles insofar as the migrants become aware of their being outside of their land, of their motherland. Although we understand the condition of exile to a political cause, this condition may also be attributed to an existential dimension, which is to me much more interesting. The migrants, who are, after all, out of their environment of provenance for reasons of social nature, often suffer from the condition of exile when they gain awareness of being thrown again in the fall, one may say, in a sort of rebirth and indeed new birth. The migrants must be born again in the land of arrival, although they may not be dead, although the being that they were in the land of provenance may not be already dead. So on the one hand, there is the Italian, so to speak, living. On the other, the person who arrives in the new land, whether it is the United States or Australia or any other, or Brazil, that new being has to be born and has to start living instead of the old being. Thus, the migrants become also familiar with a sort of condition that is in between migration and exile, the condition of expatriation. Expatriation is essentially the condition lived by those who are outside of their motherland. However, in this case, as well, the existential dimension risks confusing itself with the political dimension. The term expatriation, one might say, is a deponent term. I hope you don't mind me going into syntax. One that can be transitive and intransitive, double in its active and passive value. Therefore, expatriation is a transitive act and at the same time an intransitive act. At any rate, the expatriates often know that they are in a particular condition, which is that of those who only temporarily find themselves living expatriation. Often expatriation narrowly belongs to specific ethnic, national, cultural groups. And I'm sure you are familiar as much as I am that there are certain countries, they do not have migrants, but they only have expats. In certain countries, we certainly have migrants. I could not define myself in the United States as an expat or an exile. But certainly I can define myself as a migrant, and nobody will complain. But if you go to Florence, for instance, and you talk to the several U.S. citizens working in Florence, who have been working in Florence for years, they are expats. They are not migrants. The migrants soon come to realize that they are in a condition of duplicity. The Italian migrants migrating to the United States, to stick with this example, may be defined as Italian-American, two different words, Italian-American, one word, or Italian-American. More importantly, they become part of that migratory community that may be defined as X-American, where X is the variation of the country of provenance. And of course, here I have to refer to Anthony Tamburi's book, To Hyphenate or Not To Hyphenate. The definition of Italian-American is the initial one, Italian-American, two different words, for the first phase of the process of assimilation, or at least adaptation, in which the two identities of Italian and American are still distinctive. They start mixing in the definition of Italian-American, one word, in which the characteristics of identity from the land of provenance by now risk being confused with those of the land of destination. The definition of Italian-American perhaps might be better expressed with the definition Italian vector America, American, Italian arrow American, because that hyphen first indicates the vectorality from the country of departure to the country of arrival, and most of all, it imposes a necessity. The necessity in question is that of the acceptance of the new identity. According to the cases, which may be the most disparate, the migrants sooner or later see themselves or want to see themselves as American. Sometimes this happens because other communities, often the very fellow citizens who remained in the country of provenance, impose such a definition, because those particular migrants consider assimilation necessary, or even because within a couple of generations, those migrants discover that, if not in themselves, their legacy is American. In other words, the flow of migration in which the migrants take part and of which each migrant is but a drop breaks its waves on every land, on every water's edge, leaves its traces in random order until the rhythmic flow of those surges disperses the very traces and tracks. When the migrants are still in the condition of oscillation between the place of provenance and the place of destination, they are subjected to the nostalgia for the former and the alienation from the latter. The migrants who live their brooding on their own skin look for roots in a place and a time that belong to the past rather than measuring themselves by taking roots in actuality, in the present reality to which they belong. Only when such a rooting takes place, there may be hope that the migrants transform alienation into assimilation. However, even assimilation comes with a loss. The new roots replace the original roots. Until then, until the new roots die firmly in the new soil, the migrants are subject to some fundamental dynamics which mark their lack of belonging: the diversity of language, the distance from the habits, customs, and lifestyle of the new place, the subjection to stereotypes. In the process of assimilation, migrants inevitably distance themselves further from what was the motherland in order to make the land of arrival the new motherland. The English language, especially in the United States, has facilitated the decision of the delicate and controversial term patria. As I was saying at the beginning, motherland, fatherland, homeland are the three declensions, so to speak. The third and last of these terms identifies what the land of arrival and destination, such as the United States of America, is for many migrants: a new acquired homeland. Thank you for your patience.
I'm not going to give a presentation. I just want to build upon the fact that we know in the past we look at the migration in terms of going to the Americas, going to Australia, within Europe. And when we do that, we look at the immigration, leaving Italy. We all know that. But one of the things that I was able to do was to build a population model, a growth population model that predicts the descendants in those host countries based on the immigration data we had in the past. And the model builds on the fact, as both of you discussed, that where immigration goes into the host country, and then there are births, the descendants. There's also, as we know, many Italians that left the host country and went back to Italy, as we heard before. And the end result are the Italian descendants, which is the first generation and later on the multi-generation. It is a mathematical model, I'm not going to go through that projects the migration, the multi-generation later, and when you combine that, you get the total Italian descendant generation. And the United States, we have pretty good data since 1980 in terms of Italian-American self-identity. And in that process, and the way we did that, again, we looked at the Italian immigration and incursion, and we looked at birth and death rates as we have within the model. In doing that, we compare it to the United States census data to go and see how close we are. And what you see is that the green is the immigrants, the migrants that you're talking about, the first generation. The red is the descendants of those migrants, the births, rates as they build up over time. When you combine the two, that's your total Italian descendant in that host country, and in this case, it's the United States, which, based on our census data, came out pretty close to about 5.2%, 5.6% was the actual number. But what I want to bring out is, which touches upon some of the things you guys said, no, not that, is this intersection here, where the Italian descendants born in the host country is equal or greater than the immigrants coming into that host country. In the United States, it happens to be 1936. That was the turning point. At that point, what happens is language changes, cultural changes, which we will hear about today among the different presentations. In the case of the data that was available, that we see that year of Italianization change varies among these countries that we're talking about. And it makes sense when you talk about Brazil. That's where the first immigrants came to the Western Hemisphere. And the year of Italianization change there is 1911. So when you go to Brazil, it's got about 12% Italian descendants, that you're talking about fourth, fifth generations. Argentina, the year of Italianization change is 1918. But again, if you talk to an Argentinian, he knows about his Italian background, even though it goes back four or five generations. But he also considers himself Argentinian. And that's a very interesting situation. And then when you go to Australia, and that's why you got some of the results that you got, that the year of Italianization change is 1988. So Australia is more Italian than the United States, right? It is. And Canada is more Italian than the United States. So that's something to keep in mind, is how these populations are changing over time. But the other interesting thing from my research, and again, when we looked at that, I told you we did model it, and what we find is in Argentina, 50% of the population is Italian descendants. Usually that's given as a guess. This is actually calculated. We have Uruguay, which is about 28%. I think it's higher, between 30 and 40. Brazil. But when we get to the United States, it's only about 5%. Australia, 3%. You know, Italians are a little bit harder to find in Australia, right? And the other interesting thing is, when we look at South America as a whole, most of the population, we find that it's 18%. That means people's idea that South America is Spanish is not totally true. One out of five in South America have Italian background. Whereas in North America, it's only 5%. But the other interesting thing is, because in the United States we have census, as of 1980, people could put down two ancestries. They could put down Italian, German, Italian, Irish, Australian Italian, whatever. And when we looked at that, and we looked at the immigration to the United States, and the fact of the Italian Americans who reported that they were Italian American, but not born in Italy. They entered the United States as immigrant, but they weren't born in Italy. And that became interesting because when we matched the immigration, which is the blue, with what the people said over time where they were born, as we get to 1980, that we see that these people are not going along the immigration pattern. But when we do look at the people who say that they're Italian American and were born in Italy, it does match the immigration pattern. So what's the difference? The difference is those Italian immigrants that were born in other countries besides Italy. And again, as I said, I don't have time for the whole presentation. I just wanted to bring these things out. But one of the things is that they come, once you count them, they are all over the world globally. Not only in Western Europe, Eastern Europe, Central, Asia, and Africa. Somalia is a very good example. You know, and I've given this where some people said, oh, yeah, I was born in Ethiopia. But that's to keep in mind, that Italians were globally born in more than 88 different countries around the world. So there's a lot we need to know about the migration, about the way cultures change and so forth, and even diet. Actually, this was part of a presentation on health and nutrition we had last week on the Italian Mediterranean diet, where again the medical field is interested to know how that has evolved globally. Well, and again, anyone interested, I'll give you copies of this. I don't want to take up their time. This is their time. But you could see that Italians were born in all different countries. That's my comment.
What is the relationship between Sheikh's writing and other African Italian writers? You talked about Cristina Alifara, and so you wondered if you could put his work in connection with, for example, Farah's own work or Ijaba Shego's work. And then the second question is if race plays a role in Sheikh's writing, because from your presentation, you say that you're working on a project titled There Ain't No Black in the Tricolore, so evoke and Gilroy, so probably race is one of your interests too.
Normally I work on literature, so for me touching on upon the memoir was a bit of a stretch. I'm definitely out of my depth, so I'm much more familiar with Christina's and Shego's works than Sheikh's. As I said, the reason why I started to look into it was a very, I would say, personal reason, because 2 years ago, in November 2016, I organized a symposium in Adelaide in Australia, and I invited as guest speakers Christina and Kaha. And when Kaha came, she gave me a copy of this book as a present, and I loved it. I read it, and I sort of, as I said, even if it's out of my comfort zone, is out of my area of expertise, I want to work on it. And because, as I said, she started and just finished a crowdfunding to have those books, Arrivederci Mogadishu e La Somalia nella Isola dei Caraibi, translated into English, I thought, well, now it's about time I start to work on it. So, for example, compared to Christina Ali Farah's work, well, in my opinion, they're completely different. Christina, it's never really autobiographical. She is a creative writer and a poet, and yes, she, as any artist, I suppose, she's sort of, you know, get inspiration from her own life, other people's life, but in the case of Sheikh, it's virtually an autobiography, and I think it's very intense. So from a literary point of view, again, my background is not on memoirs, I'm not really, but I think it's, in my opinion, as I said, it's very intense, because he's telling the story of Somalia and Somali, and the Somali history and the time of the dictatorship from a very privileged point of view. He was one of the people who believed that an initial time of dictatorship can actually push and the change and make the change quicker and more effective. And everything started changing when they were demanding a democratization of the dictatorship, and they realized that Siad Barre wasn't ready to give an inch of his power to the people. And I think that he's very clear. It's taking all his own responsibilities, but he's also sharing what his dreams were. And I think that's, from an historical point of view and even from a literary point of view, that's very interesting. So yeah, I hope I sort of touch on what you were saying. And in terms of my project, again, very early stages, I suppose. And again, thank you to Archie's. So yeah, I will go into that. But at the moment, yes, I'm focusing on try to link post-colonial literature and the current situation in Italy, the social political situation, which is changing dramatically. And it's very hard for me to keep up with it, but I'll do my best. So I hope. Thank you.
I have a question. I missed why he was put in jail, incarcerated.
The reasons are not extremely clear. In the book, it actually says it doesn't really know, and until the mock trial, basically, nobody knew what he was accused of. So the real reasons are simply because he was completely clashing with Siad Barre. He sort of he was put in jail before once, and then released, and he was offered another position to sort of
put the situation at ease, and then at the end, when he was really strong in terms of asking for he and other, at least two political who were incarcerated as well, they were very vocal and they were asking for a process of democratization. That was it. So the day before, if I'm not mistaken, he had his last meeting with Siad Barre, and the dictator pretended everything was okay, that things will be, you know, smooth and everything. And then one day, just the military, the army stormed into his place. Actually, he wasn't at home, because he was, that's not in the book. It was in the countryside because he was collecting oral poetry. He was recording oral poetry in the country. So the army stormed into his place. There were his children. They were shocked. And what they did, what the military did, they shot at their dog. And that is in the book. What is not in the book again is that clearly when they didn't find him there, they ran away, so, and the kids were shocked. They knew their father was about to be incarcerated. The dog was shot. And so they diligently went to school. One of his brother, one of Sheikh brother, grabbed that dog. And remember, we are in a Muslim country, and the dog is hib. The dog is impure. So he grabbed his dog. He ran to the closest vet. And again, the vet were used to, you know, cure camels, like big animals, big farm animals, not pets. So he grabs his dog, ran to the vet, put the dog on the vet table and say, "Now you please save this dog because my nephew and nieces went through enough today. I don't want them to lose their dog as well." And the vet touched the dog, saved the dog, and long live the dog. So that's how the thing went down. So they were a very, you know, peculiar and incredible family. And I'm very lucky to know Kaha personally. And I'm very sorry that I didn't have the chance to meet him.
Yeah, but it sounds like the, you know, they were intimidating him. Like all along, yes.
It's a curious coincidence. Elisabetta D'Amanda from Rochester Institute of Technology, Rochester, New York. I run a series every year, and it's called Viva l'Italia. it's the second year we open with a concert. And the performing arts faculty came to me with Castelnuovo because we were talking about diaspora. And now, having listened to both of your presentation, one notion came clear to me of the disappearance of these musicians within the United States framework, because I've never heard of them. You know, Italian musicians have been very popular, very, you know, kind of a iconic scenario, and so I, if you wouldn't mind elaborate a little bit more on this, because it seems an important piece, and since I'm going to have to present, because my scholarship is in Italian cinema, so they put me in charge of this, so I think I need to pick your brain on on this a bit more.
Go for it.
Yeah, actually, Mario Castelnuovo Tedesco worked with Hollywood,
right. So
he wrote a lot of music for the movies. But he was, because he was not very proud of this. He was a really famous composer, classic composer. So, and he changed his name, actually. But yeah, he composed a lot in Hollywood. And Mario Castelnuovo Tedesco is not only my opinion, but also the historical scholars think that he is the most famous composer that exiled from it, and had also a very he was very popular also in United States. And this year is, if I'm not wrong, is the anniversary of his birth, I think, something like that. But yeah, so yeah, he exiled from Italy because he was Jew, and he was not forced to exile, but this was the only way to save his life and the life of his family. And he wrote a book. There is an autobiography of his life. There is I think it's all in Italian actually, and it's amazing because he, in one part, he talk about when he, because he's from Florence, so he went to say hello to his parents, and it's very touching. And then he went to Trieste, took the boat to United States, and for him was very difficult all of this because he was the most famous composer in Italy. But he became very famous in Italy because Segovia, there is a very famous guitar player. So yeah, exactly. So he, Segovia performed his music. So from this point, he became very famous actually. And he arrived in United States because there is, of course, the network and connections with other composers. And at the time, we have to remember that in Los Angeles lived Arno Schoenberg, Igor Stravinsky, so was like very famous composer, and this composer, they knew each other. So, but yeah, in Italy, what's happened after the fall of fascism and after the war was that we actually forgot all these musicians and composers. There is a case of in 1950 something, I don't remember exactly the date, that the Minister of Culture and Music, whatever, he wrote a letter to Vittorio Rieti. There was another composer that settled in New York, very famous in New York. He said, now we have a democracy, republic, come back. He said, probably it's too late now. So, because after, it was 10 years after the no, what, I don't remember actually who wrote, no. Yeah, I don't remember, yeah. But the Italian government completely was like, forgot all these composer and musician. That in the case of that I thought about Gualtiero Volterra, that he returned to Italy, this was his choice. But the rest of the composer, Vittorio Rieti, Mario Castelnuovo Tedesco, Renzo Massarani, they remain in Italy, in the host country all the time. But I suggest probably to read his biography. Yeah. And I don't remember exactly, is Una Vita in Musica, something like that. But it's very, I think in every public library, you can find it very easily. Yeah, but we put this quotation on the end of our presentation because it's a very strong witness of what we mean, leave a country, and he said, it was like la prova generale della morte, so he's like, wow, yeah.
My name is Barbara Spadaro. I have a question for this wonderful paper from Alessandro and Laura, which I think opens up very interesting perspective on the idea of being exiled from ideas of Italianness, really. Like, I found interesting how Aden and Farah have this feeling of identification from Somalia and then discover by going to Italy how Somali are invisible and how actually they can feel rejected by it. But then he would come back by saying, even if I would back to Somalia, I wouldn't give up with my Italianness. So it's really a process of identification and disidentification. And I was wondering if Alessandro can expand a little bit on that regarding the Jewish composers, like in terms of feelings of Jewishness and Italianness. Because I was intrigued, for example, by the fact that Volterra's wife was not Jewish. So, I mean, this is part of the picture, probably, of to what extent he would feel his Jewish identity to be stronger after the experience of exile, but being married to a non-Jewish woman. So I was hoping that you can expand a little bit on this navigating between feeling of Italianness and Jewishness and the experience of exile of the two composers.
Yes, I think it's a process. And I think that for Farah, the problem was that he never felt safe. So that was sort of a kind of an impediment to explore his potential Italianness. And I think that going back to Ijaba Shego's, one of her first short stories and quite famous is this Matria, and is going again to the word of, you know, patria, matria. And in this specific short stories, she's talking about the fact that they were all dismatriati, they were all, you know, people without a madre patria, without a mother. And then in her family, nobody was using wardrobes and everyone was using luggage. Suitcases, so to store their belongings, so they were always ready to go back. But one day she sort of makes everyone open their own suitcases, and her mother has four with her belongings, but then she had a fifth, and she asks the narrator to open it, and when they open it, they had a little, you know, statue of the Lupa di Roma and a pack of spaghetti and all Italian things. And she concludes the short story saying, you know, that the mother says, well, if we are about to go back to Somalia, I didn't want to forget about Italy. I want to keep some mementos. I want to have a bit of my Italianness with me. So I think that in literature and even in the memoir of Shakes, you have this building process of Italianness, this sort of, then for Somali it's very, you know, complicated because of the colonial past and all that, all the trauma and all that, but it's still very intense and somehow interesting from my perspective, at least.
Yeah. So the example of Volterra, that he married a non-Jewish wife, I think is a paradigmatic of the story of the Jews in Italy. So compare other European countries in the sense that the Jews in Italy participate to the First World War, to the Risorgimento, so was very integrated, and after the assimilation was like they felt more like Italian than Jewish. And for example, there is Alton, there is Jews that died during the resistance in Italy. He always said, who are you? I'm Italian communist Jews. So this is how the Jews felt himself, I think, themselves in Italy. And according also to Michele Sarfatti, especially in the period before the promulgation of the racial law, Jewish population in Italy was really not into religion, very observant. It was very common, especially in places like Firenze, where Volterra came, and Trieste, another one, and Milano, the marriage was mixed. And why he married this woman from Australia? Because she she went to Florence to do some Italian course or something like that. And he was an antiquarian at the moment, so he stopped to be a pianist. And I think because the story, we don't have many documents about Volterra. They met like in a shop, or she went to buy something, a portrait, I don't know. But yeah, I think Volterra was not really into Jewish religion. I think he was like, as many other Italian Jewish, like a kind of origin from, but he felt like it's more Italian probably than the Jewish. But yeah, I don't. No, probably it's not the...
No, it's it's exactly the kind of feeling that I'm interested in too, because before the racial law, because of the integration of Jews into liberal Italy and into Italy in general, it felt like this heritage was about to be lost. Yeah. But then the trauma of racial law made it much... suddenly evident, important, and so many people who experienced exile or other trauma revalued it. Yeah. So this became again very important in their lives. But I was interested to know if you had found something about it in the case studies that you are looking at.
So the problem is the documents are a few about this specific case of musicians and composers. It's very complicated. I have some documents from family from Massarani, her niece, his niece, but it's very... I went to Rome to the National Archive and I didn't find anything about Massarani or Volterra.
My question is, one of the things that you mentioned was that many times Italian immigrants feel ethnic or hyphenated because they're seen as something other when they go home to Italy by Italians themselves. And I'm thinking in particular of times during fascism when even Mussolini himself would make speeches dedicated to the specific group of immigrants abroad, telling them, affirming to them that they are Italian, come home. And maybe now there's a small movement, or a vocal movement in Italy that is again nationalistic. But in between, as you had mentioned, there is a hesitancy to even use the word patria, to refer to the sort of national identity, which now we're seeing resurgence of not only in Italy, but you know, in Germany, the discussion of Heimat is almost the same. And so my question is, to what degree is resistance in considering oneself Italian at home, or one's former home in Italy, a large factor in discerning who they are while abroad? And one of the reasons why I ask that is, you know, does that change based on socioeconomic status? You know, certainly there are very many Italians living in this city who have been here for 40 and 50 years who barely speak English. I know personally a number of these people, right? And it'd be very hard for them to make an argument that they're very American, and they'd be the first to admit it. And others who maybe have very quickly assimilated and simply haven't returned, in the case of some other people, since the 1950s or 60s.
I was touching upon this aspect very briefly in the paper, referring to the fact that often the migrants find their own definition when they're abroad, rather than when they are at home. They realize that they are Italian the moment in which they come to the United States, and everybody is addressing them as Italians. You know, like I was thinking about Primo Levi, who also said, "Well, you know, the racial laws allowed me to realize that I am Jewish." until then, he was thinking he was Italian first of all. There is this need of the other as an entity that defines me. And as long as the other is not the other, I'm living in Italy surrounded by supposedly Italians. All of them are Italians as much as I am. I don't even think that I am Italian. And I just assume that I am Italian. The moment I leave Italy to move to the United States, for instance, that's the moment when I realize that I am Italian, because they tell me that I'm not American, because when I speak English, I don't speak English the way they do, because when I want to have dinner, I have it at a different time, I cook different things, et cetera, et cetera. No? The example you were giving of, you know, people who live in the United States and they are not integrated in the United States, and yet they are not Italian at the same time anymore, are similar also, no, to the Somali people who move to Italy. Inevitably, the moment one leaves one's own country, one is doomed to assume a new identity, or rather, one is doomed to be aware of the assumption of a new identity. And that assumption, when I was focusing on expatriation and the transitive-intransitive mode of expatriation, I was referring to that. You know, I don't have to embrace the definition that is given to me. Regardless, that definition is given to me. I may not recognize myself as Italian-American, but people may define me as Italian-American. I may insist as much as I like that I am an Italian living in the United States. You know, this was very hot in the 90s, especially in New York City and New England. But people will call me Italian-American. I can go back to Italy and say that I'm Italian. My friends will always tell me, you don't understand what's going on here because you are American now. No? So, you know, you see that and by now, my friends have become the other, as much as the person born in the United States, who grew up in the United States, et cetera, will define me as Italian. I still have to go to the barber, ask for a haircut. I'm asked how I would like the haircut. I will go fairly short, and the barber will say, where are you from? You know, those little things do make you realize that you are, whether I like it or not, an outsider. You know, I don't speak the way people speak in Wisconsin. And an outcast, you know, even though, you know, there is this rhetoric of, I willingly left the country, you know? And so many of us can say that. And especially in the United States, that's the kind of rhetoric one wants to embrace, because I am a self-made man or woman, right? I made the decision. It's my choice. I own it, right? Actually, you know, then when we scratch the surface of this rhetoric, we realize that there are economic, social, cultural reasons, class reasons that force one to leave. Then, of course, you know, we need to have this patina, this rhetorical patina that allow us to be active in that event that really changes the life of that individual. And that's what I was trying to address in the paradigm I'm trying to build. You know, there are layers. No, to these definitions, of migrant, expatriate, exile, especially, and these layers are all taken into consideration the kind of relationship an individual has, or even an ethnic group has, with that event, which is birth or rebirth. New birth. When I was talking about the migrants falling into a condition, yes, I was trying to be Heideggerian, but basically the migrants inevitably, you know, even the people you are referring to, find themselves living in a world in which, you know, the inner self is at a certain level and the outer self is a child. They have to speak English if they want to communicate, but they cannot speak English the way they would speak Italian. And they have to learn a new language, and the new language is not only English, but it's also the habits, the customs, the lifestyle. You know, you don't cook spaghetti meatballs on Wednesday night at 6, you know, if you are American, right? You know, all these things that have to be they have to be learned.
And what is interesting is what was mentioned, and it shows in this data here that as I said, in the census, they could identify two ancestries. But there's a tendency of identifying Italian first. So there's more likely a feeling. And these are, as I mentioned, people that were not born in Italy, like the Samoan. But they identify Italian first more than their second ancestry, except for South America and Central America. And that might be because there were an older immigration, and also they evolved in that country a lot quicker. I'm sure in Australia it took a while for Italians to become citizens. But in Argentina, within a year, they got into the political system. So that, I think, affects it also. Okay, and, you know, like also I like to say, since I have him here, Kama Petiruso, Isla Pelazzoli, like, you know, help me with this presentation.
Thank you, Ernesto, for your presentation. Very, very interesting. I just would like to say that the process that you describe about migrants, Italian migrants who became Italian in the U.S., it's exactly the same in France, you know, immigrants from Italy who came in France are not Italian. Motherland means nothing. The motherland is la piccola patria, the village. They became Italian in the relationship with the French society. In the other end, I would like to know what do you think, I would like to know what do you think about, you know, the impact of the Italian politics toward migrants. As you know, Italian state has a discourse about la madre patria, has a link to maintain a link between Italy and migrants. And is it possible to have an idea about the effect, the impact of this discourse, about this politics?
Contemporary politics or?
Yeah, I mean, since the 19th century.
Patria was a positive term, to use an adjective that doesn't mean much, but you understand positive, until fascism, really. The two examples that come to mind are not politicians, but writers. However, no, they are in a way, you know, they give us a sense of the pride, even, that Italians had in a term such as patria. And of course, you know, French had it in patrie, etc. Edmondo de Amicis, you know, Edmondo de Amicis, as much as we may not like Cuore, but that book was crucial. And Giovanni Pascoli. Giovanni Pascoli, somebody was talking about the Società Dante Alighieri, you know, this morning, and Giovanni Pascoli was one of the promoters of that Società, was one of the few intellectuals in Italy who understood the importance of the relationship Italy and Italians would have with the colonies. Granted, he understood it in a problematic way, right? You know, that essay that he writes at the time of the war in Libya, La grande proletaria si è mossa. No, already in the title is problematic, you know, because this great proletarian And then there is a feminine noun that is missing, and I like to believe it's Italia, of course, but also Madre Patria, especially when one reads the text. It ends with this image of the Italian soldiers rescuing the Arab children and bringing them to Italy, and finally allowing them to live and to embrace culture. No, that is a problematic statement, right? because it, you know, because of the assumption that Italy has culture and the world in which they live does not have culture. However, it seems to be very prophetic, no, in terms of what happens later, and that tells you how much emphasis there is on the patriotic discourse until World War One, or rather until World War Two. The problem is that between World War One and World War Two, fascism gives a different understanding, a different tone, a different color to that rhetoric, and afterwards the situation changes drastically, so that in the 60s and 70s, later on, and even in the 80s, you could not say the word patria in Italy without being defined as a fascist. In the 90s, you know, Ciampi tried to reintegrate the term patria, but today, you know, with the political climate that there is in Italy, again, it's becoming a problematic term, politically speaking.